All right. Looks like the students like the doctrine of sin so much, they all came back before time and sat down in their places. Excellent. Okay. Yeah. We talked about a lot of things, a lot of heavy things, but very, very important things for our Christian walk. So let's kind of, you know, sum up this big thought which we were trying to cover before we move on to other things. So basically, what are we saying? When a kid is born, that kid already has the sinful nature inside them. So there are times when they are able to rule over the sin crouching at the door. There are times when they're unable to rule over the sin crouching at the door, you know, because of that whole idea of total depravity. We are unable to be perfect in keeping all of the laws of God. Some of them we are able to keep, some of them we fail to keep. So as a kid, maybe, you know, there was cake sitting on the table and, you know, mommy had said, do not touch the cake. It's for the guests in the evening. So I resist the temptation and I successfully overcome the temptation and I do not sin. I do not steal. But then that evening when I go to play with the other kids, someone says something to me and what do? I punch that child. So I successfully kept myself from sinning with regard to the cake. But there on the playground, I lost it. You know, I ended up sinning. So it's like a case of 50-50. Sometimes I will succeed. Sometimes I will not succeed. Why? Because that sinful nature inside me is controlling me. So maybe my attachment to cake is not that much. So I was able to overcome that temptation. But I'm somebody who has a big ego. So when the other kid said something to me on the playground, I could not handle that. Cake, I can resist. But when people say things to me, oh, I can't. So I punch the child. So I didn't do that, okay? I mean, it's just a fictional example. So you know, it's like that. So there are some things, in some cases, we are able to rule over sin. And in other cases, we are unable to rule over sin. The things which are, where we are more enslaved, in those areas, we give in. We are unable to succeed. But in other areas, maybe where we are not that deeply enslaved, we are able to rule over sin. That's the kind of very unsuccessful life that unbelievers lead. But then when this child comes to Jesus Christ and, you know, now makes a commitment to the Lord that he is going to follow the Lord from now on. And he says, I believe that you are going to forgive me of my sins because you died on the cross for me. I believe it. I accept it. Now I choose to follow you. I have turned my back on my sinful ways. And now there will be no more stealing, no more punching. You know, Lord, now I'm going to be following you. I will honor you. The Lord takes you seriously, you know, at your word. And he gives you his salvation experience. So in that moment, that child is, what is, so this is what happens to the child. You know, we talked about it. We touched upon it last time when we were looking at the doctrine of humanity. Let's repeat that same thought once again. What happens in that moment of salvation? Something extraordinary, something divine happens. It's not a New Year resolution that you're making and saying, okay, from now on, I'm going to follow the Lord. It's not just a New Year resolution. You yourself are getting changed into something else. Something very momentous is happening to you in that moment of salvation. So Romans chapter 6, verses 6 to 7, if someone could read out. Romans 6, 6 to 7. Yeah, anyone online, I don't mind, online in the class, Romans 6, 6 to 7.
Knowing this, that
anyone at all.
Yes, sister. Knowing this, that our old man was crucified with him, that the body of sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves of sin.
Hey, no. Somebody's reading out over there. I mean, in the sense I can see the audio here is not connected, is it? I mean, maybe because of that we cannot hear what the online people are reading out. But yeah, Lucy actually read it out. Thanks.
Yes, seventh verse.
All right. Here. Yeah, I could not hear it, but thanks for reading out the verse for us. You know, they'll rectify that over here so that, you know, we will be able to hear whenever you guys read out. They will take care of it over here. So the what this verse is basically saying is that when that child comes to the Lord and makes a commitment saying, yes, Lord, from now on, I have repented of my sin and I will be your follower because I have placed my faith in you. So from that moment on, in that moment, that child, who that person was, who is the child? The child is a spirit being. The child is a spirit being with a soul, you know, mind, will, emotions, and a physical body. So that child in that moment is crucified along with Christ. It's very openly saying that in Romans chapter 6, verse 6, that person in that moment of having placed their faith in Lord, in the Lord Jesus and has made a commitment to him, in that moment, that person, that spirit being is crucified, killed, dead, buried. So that person is no longer alive. But even in that moment, as that person is crucified and dies, in that same moment, the Holy Spirit rebirths that person into a new creation. So the child died, but the child is now made alive by the Holy Spirit into a brand new creation. Someone who actually carries the, you could say, someone who carries the DNA of God in them now. Because earlier, they had been birthed humanly through their human parents. But now, in that moment of being crucified with Jesus Christ, God rebirthed them as a new creation. So now that new person, that child is no longer what that child was earlier. Now this child is a new person altogether with the DNA of God in them. You know, because, you know, in John, he talks about the seed of Christ and all of that. Let's not get into all of those details. We will cover those things in future sessions. But yeah, so this is who this person is now. So now, whereas earlier this person could only rule over sin now and then, it's no longer the case. Now this person is a new creation with the DNA of God in them. So now they can start ruling over sin more and more and more successfully, become more and more sanctified, live more and more victoriously. This is not something that the person could do earlier. But now, because now they have become a new creation, they will be able to do that, which is why it says in Romans 6, verse 6, it says, the old self was crucified with Jesus so that the body ruled by sin might be done away with. Earlier, the body did what it wanted. The person did not have much control over the, over here when we're talking about the word body, we're talking about the sinful soul, you know, the old mind processes and the sinful body, the old habits which the physical body had developed. All those things can now be done away with. Why? Because this person got crucified, that helpless, weak, enslaved person who cannot rule over sin, that person got crucified with Christ. And now, in that moment when that person was crucified, the Holy Spirit himself personally rebirthed that person into a new creation. So now this person definitely has the ability to rule over sin. But of course, if they continue to set their mind on the wrong things, their heart will continue to be upon those wrong things. So they have to make a conscious effort to now reset their mind, take their mind off those old things and to reset them on godly things so that their mind and body will get a chance to start being renewed into what Christ wants. Okay, so that was the major thought that we tried to, you know, cover up to this point. Now let's look at some things that are told in the scriptures about this whole, you know, concept of sin. You know, one of the most common words, you would have heard this in sermons, one of the most common words that are used in the New Testament for that word sin, it's that word hamartia, H-A-M-A-R-T-I-A. In fact, the doctrine of sin, you you know, I didn't want to unleash that term on you, but the actual technical term for doctrine of sin is hamartiology. Okay, so hamartia is sin. And that's the word which is the Greek word which is used most often in the New Testament. And also in sermons, you would have heard that hamartia literally means to miss the mark. It is an archery term. You know, when you shoot the arrow, you hit the mark rather than missing the mark if you are a good archer, if you're good with your bow and arrow. Let's actually look at one example. It's an Old Testament scripture. So someone who can, you know, turn in their Bibles to the Old Testament and look at Judges chapter 20, verse 16. Judges chapter 20, verse 16, if someone could read out. It says something about archery, you know, about bows and arrows. Judges 20, verse 16.
Judges chapter 20, verse 16. Among all these people, there were 700 chosen men, left-handed, everyone called sailing stones at our hair, but and not miss.
Okay, that was not a nice translation. In the sense it didn't convey the idea. Basically, in this verse, it's talking about 700 soldiers who were left-handed, who had this very unique ability and skill. You know, if a guy is standing many, many feet away, holding one single human hair, okay, he's standing over there, and in his hand is holding one single human hair. These 700 soldiers, they are so skilled. Their aim is so accurate that, you know, they can take a stone and hit that particular human hair, which a man is holding many, many feet away. Their aim is that accurate. That is basically hitting the mark. Even though the mark is like so difficult to hit, they are able to accurately hit the mark. In the same way, God has set standards for us humans. You know, the way He wants us to live, the kind of holy lifestyle that He wants us to have. So, like those 700 soldiers, we are meant to hit the exact mark and say, yes, Lord, what you wanted, you know, in my attitudes, in my motives, in my actions, in my speech, in my relationships, I have hit the mark in all of those things, exactly what you wanted. I aimed for it and I achieved it, is what, you know, we should be able to say. We continue to hold on to an unrenewed mind, we tend to be unable to hit the mark. So which is why on a daily basis, we make a choice to reset our thinking, reset our choices and say, I'm going to focus on godly things so that my desires will start becoming more godly, so that, you know, the things which go on in my mind day after day will all be godly things, because those are the things which I'm now focusing on. Then you will be willing to cooperate with the Holy Spirit, you know, in hitting the mark rather than always missing the mark. So if we are constantly missing the mark, one question that we can ask ourselves is, am I following what was taught in Romans chapter 8, verse 5? You know, where it says, those who have their minds set on what the Spirit desires, they will be able to live victoriously. You know, so we need to ask ourselves whether it's because of our unrenewed thinking, you know, because we have still set our eyes on the wrong things, is it because of that we are constantly missing the mark? Before we move on, you know, this question which Andrew has posted here in the chat, he talks about how we believers have been delivered from various bondages. We have been delivered from various kinds of bondages. So when it says that we believers have been delivered from the curse of bondages, is it talking about spiritual deliverance or is it talking about physical deliverance? Yes, it is very much true that now that we are under Jesus Christ in his kingdom, as long as we were in the kingdom of darkness, we were under the control of Satan and sin. And sin and Satan could bind us in whatever way they wished to. But once we were taken out of that kingdom and brought into the kingdom of the Son of God, now, obviously, sin and Satan cannot hold us in bondage. But in many cases, because we continue to have an unrenewed thinking and we have not set our minds on the things of God, we will continue to experience some level of bondage. It could be both spiritual and physical. Because, you know, if a person was being oppressed by demons before salvation, after salvation, the demons cannot have much control over him. But even now, after salvation, they can continue to come and try and trouble him in so many different ways. You know, maybe not allow him to sleep in the night, maybe create a lot of fear inside him, you know, where he's not unable to focus on scriptures. They can continue to hold you in bondage to some extent or the other. So those could be physical ways, mental ways in which they try to continue controlling you. Why? Because you are still, even though now you're in the kingdom of the Son of God, your mind is still sitting over there in the other kingdom, which is why it's so important for us to bring our mind and body into this kingdom where we now belong. Then Satan and sin will not have any hold over us. They will be unable to hold us in bondage anymore. Because now we have, you know, we are daily, on a daily basis, we are placing ourselves under Christ more and more. In our thinking, in our attitudes, absorbing those scriptures, understanding them, reflecting upon them, where our thoughts are now in line with scripture. You know, in your dreams, you start dreaming more spiritual things. Have you noticed that? I remember this. Been a lot of contrast in the way I used to dream earlier. I mean, I've been a believer my whole life, not a very renewed believer. So, you know, back then, my dreams were so different. But now, I mean, I notice you have more, in my dreams, I go to a prayer meeting, I'll be sitting over there, or I'll be sitting and reading. I never used to get such dreams. I mean, they're just dreams, okay, nothing great. But I'm just saying, your thinking and your priorities change to a level where even your dreams also change. You know, because now your entire mind is focused on a different set of things. In your question here, your question is very basic. You're saying, you know, the deliverance, does it happen at the physical level or at the spiritual level? At a spiritual level, every believer is delivered. They stand delivered because now they are no longer in that old kingdom. They are now citizens of a new kingdom. So spiritually, yes, the deliverance has taken place because when you were renewed and created into a new creation by the Holy Spirit, no longer are you sitting in that kingdom. You, the new creation, are in God's kingdom now. So spiritual deliverance has taken place. But at a physical level, at an emotional level, at a mental level, if you have not yet come under, you know, the control of the Holy Spirit more and more, the evil ones can continue to meddle, you know, with your mind and your feelings and your priorities to the extent, that they can. So when it comes to physical deliverance and mental deliverance, that would be something that happens even as you disciple, you know, even as you undergo discipleship, even as you choose to follow Christ more and more. I'm not sure whether that really clearly answers your question or not. I was just trying to, explain all aspects of the question. I hope that helped. But if you have a follow-up question, okay, perfect. Yeah, thank you. All right. So we were talking about people, those 700 soldiers who could literally hit the mark. And if we choose to, walk in line with the Spirit on a daily basis, we will find ourselves also hitting God's mark again and again, you know, rather than missing the mark all the time. So there are two kinds of three kinds of sins which believers should watch out for. Generally, everyone talks about the sins of commission, so we'll not start with that. Let's first talk about the sins of omission. These are terms which you probably would have heard in sermons, you know, where the preacher says the sins of commission and omission, and you wonder what on earth, you know, they're talking about. So a sin of omission is basically this. We believers have been told, you know, what is right, what is wrong. Even as we are reading the scriptures, even as we are growing in God, we can feel the convicting of the Holy Spirit. You know, when we try to do something wrong, immediately the Holy Spirit convicts us. He tells us, no, this is the good which I taught you, remember? This is the way we should be treating fellow believers. This is the way we should be working hard in sharing the gospel. This is the right priorities that we should have. So there are many, many good things which the Holy Spirit has been teaching us in our daily walk, during our devotions, when we are listening to the sermons in church. There are many, many good things which we already know because the Holy Spirit is teaching us those things. A sin of omission is, even though you know those things, you choose not to do it. That becomes a sin of omission. You know, so you're already aware of the good things that you are supposed to be doing, but you choose not to do that. And in God's eyes, that will be a sin of omission. You knew the good which God wants you to do, but you deliberately chose to omit it. You chose not to do it. To use a very simple example, the parable of the Good Samaritan, where the priest and the Levite, definitely they would have known that they are supposed to love their neighbor as themselves. Now, this is a command. These are people in the full-time ministry, the priest and the Levite. So obviously they would know the two most important commandments, to love the Lord with all your heart, soul, and mind, and also to love your neighbor as yourself. So they knew the good which they should do. But what did they do? They chose not to act upon it. They committed a sin of omission. Now, this is, rather difficult. This is basically where a lot of us believers miss out. Sins of commission, deliberate sins where we deliberately go against what God is telling us to do, we try to avoid those. We generally don't steal. We generally are not murderers. We definitely don't rob banks. We are very careful about avoiding the sins of commission. But in this area of sins of omission, we say, oh Lord, I'm busy with this and that. So no, I can't really do this good thing which you are asking me to do. So we try to escape. We try to find excuses to avoid doing the good which we know that we should do with regard to sharing the gospel, with regard to maybe helping another believer who is in need, with regard to serving in the church, helping out and volunteering in ministry. These are all good things which we know we should do, but we try to come up with excuses to avoid doing those things because it would involve sacrifice. It would involve, having to give up some things to do those good things. So we come up with excuses. So I think on Judgment Day, maybe we will not really be judged that much for sins of commission, but I think a lot of us would end up getting judged for sins of omission. So maybe this is something, tomorrow, if you're a person who has your devotions in the evening, this evening, or tomorrow morning, if you're a person who has your devotions in the morning, you could go into the Lord's presence and say, Lord, I don't know to what extent I'm really avoiding the sin of omission. Please, Lord, help me to stop coming up with excuses and instead do what you're putting in my heart to do. The good things which you are putting in my heart to do, let me be a person who is immediately acts upon it. Even as you sense in your heart the Holy Spirit saying, why don't you do this good thing? Instead of coming up with three excuses of why it cannot be done, Lord, help me to be a person who will actually just do it. Then I think that day, many of us can avoid, we can have a better judgment day, when that day comes. Sins of commission, on the other hand, are your deliberate acts of disobedience. God says, thou shalt not steal. You deliberately go and steal. The Lord says, you shall obey your, honor your parents, and you dishonor them in the way you treat them. This is a direct rebellion against whatever God has committed. So sins of commission is God says something and you go and do the exact opposite. That would be a sin of commission. And we generally believers try to avoid that. We know there are some really bad, sinful things and we do not want to, you know, dishonor God by doing those. So we generally try to avoid sins of commission. There's a third way in which we could end up sinning, where we are doing a good thing, but we are not doing the good thing which God wanted us specifically to do. For instance, He wants everyone to earn and, you know, to have a job, to earn their livelihood. But then if God has been, you know, kind of saying in your heart, no, my child, I don't want you to go abroad. Yes, it's true. Everyone else in your youth group is going abroad. But I think I want you to stay here in this country. And, you know, you go and apply for a job in Canada or wherever. It's a good thing that you're doing. You know, it's good to earn a livelihood. It's good to, you know, apply for job interviews. But that good thing, if it is not God's will for you and He has made that known to you, and if you still act upon that good thing, for you, it's very much a sin. For the other person who has applied to Canada, if the Lord has not said anything to him, you know, he has every right to go ahead with that because the Lord has not urged him in his heart to refrain from doing that. But for you specifically, it would be a sin. Yeah, someone was about to say something. Mm-hmm. I don't know. I have no idea. This is just a teaching. This is not part of the formal doctrine. No, the formal doctrinal stuff has got big, big terms. This is just common sense teaching in the sense, you know, it's true because many of us believers make this mistake where in the area of motives, oh my, we really miss out on this. We all serve in church. We are so careful to volunteer when it comes to, you know, godly ministry things. But sometimes we do it with the wrong motive because, you know, a person may think, oh, if I volunteer on Sundays, then the Lord will give me a promotion. If I volunteer on Sundays, then people will think, you know, they'll think, oh, what a committed person she is. So again, those also are sins. So they would fall into this third category where you're doing good things, but you're doing it with the wrong motive. And when the Lord catches that, He will raise up that point on judgment day, how awkward it will be. So, you know, it's a prayer that I pray, Lord, please let good judgment day be good for me. Help me to clean up my act now while I still have a chance. Otherwise, Lord, you know, I'm a teacher. I stand in front of people and say big things. On judgment day, Lord, if I'm in one pathetic condition, how humiliating it would be. You know, so we all should have this deep desire to avoid this sense of omission, to be very careful about doing good things which God wants us to do, make sure that we are in the will of God, make sure that our motives are right when we are doing those good things, and of course, sins of commission that we should avoid. Whatever God said, do not do, we must avoid doing those things. That anyway is, of course, it's a must. Coming to another aspect, that we can dwell upon. Sin, if you notice, is basically a contradiction of what is true. It's a contradiction of what is right. It's even a contradiction of who God says you are. So sin basically wants to contradict God. If God says something is true, sin will say, oh, is it really true? And if God says something is right, sin will say, to what extent is it right? Maybe it's partially right. So sin always tries to contradict God. You know, and of course, the basic example we can use is from the Genesis passage. Look at the wording over there. I mean, if you were to look at the NIV in Genesis chapter 2, verse 17, this is what the Lord says about, you know, not eating that particular fruit from the tree of good and evil, from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. This is what God says. He says, for when you, in Genesis 2:17, the Lord says, when you eat from it, you will certainly die. Definitely, 101%, you will die. So the Lord says, when you eat from it, you will certainly die. And what does Satan say in Genesis 3:4? He says to the woman, you will not certainly die. A direct contradiction. God says this is truth, and sin will say, no, this is what God is saying is wrong. Okay, that sin also contradicts what God says is right. In the sense, if you're continuing to look at that same passage, there God says in Genesis 2:17, for when you eat from it, you will certainly die. In the sense, God is saying, the consequences of disobeying this particular command is very, very dangerous. It will destroy you. Death will come upon you. That's basically what God is saying. But then when Satan talks about this, he says, when you eat from it, what did God say? When you eat from it, you will certainly die. Now, Satan is taking the same wording. And what does he say? When you eat from it, your eyes will be opened. And then he says, you will be like God, knowing good and evil. So when God says that something is right, sin will contradict what God is saying. And this is what we see, happens with Adam and Eve. Sin contradicts what God is saying about Adam and Eve, about their status, about their position, about their future. Because what is this false promise that Satan makes to them? He says, if you eat of it, then your eyes will be opened, and then when you sin against God and eat of that fruit, at that time you will become like God, is what Satan says. But when you look at your Genesis, Genesis chapter 1, verse 26, God says, let us make man in our image, in our likeness. Adam and Eve were already in the likeness of God. They didn't need to commit a sin to become like God. God had already freely, generously, liberally made them in his likeness. Satan, look at the way he, deceived them. They already were in the likeness of God. What does Satan say? Say, if you sin against God and if you eat that fruit, then you will be like God. Then you will know good and evil. But the thing is, Adam already was very knowledgeable. He already was very, very wise. In fact, God brings all the animals, all the creation which God has made, he brings it to Adam and says, because you are so wise, you will be able to name these creatures correctly. You will be able to study their behavior, their structure, the manner in which they have been programmed, and you will be able to give the right labeling for each one of them. And Adam was actually able to do that. This Adam, he was already like God. He already was very wise. And here, Satan comes and says something so wrong. And Satan does the same thing with us today. He uses sin to try and deceive us. So we already have a very high status and a very high future in God. It's already guaranteed for us. When we came into the kingdom of the Son of God, all the spiritual blessings were given to us. Our status is already very high. Our future is already very secure. The only thing is that the circumstances that we are going through right now may not always be favorable. We go through hardships. People may go against us. But these are temporary things. If we can hold on to the truth about our high status, if we can hold on to the truth about the future which God, has said. He said he has got a good future for us. If we can hold on to those truths and continue to trust and obey, these temporary circumstances will pass. The circumstances will not stay forever. So it's only the circumstances which sometimes are unfavorable, but the status which we have, that is already established, that we are the sons of God and all the spiritual blessings are ours. So Satan deceived Adam and Eve and tried to give them something which they actually already had. And in their foolishness, they sinned. And that is what Satan tries to do with us today. He comes to us and he says, Yeah, you're supposed to have all the spiritual riches. But go look at your wallet. See how much money there is in your wallet right now. What spiritual riches? On the other hand, if you compromised a little bit at your workplace, you know, and won the favor of the boss, then maybe you would get your promotion. Then your wallet will be full. Then you'll actually be rich, is what sin and Satan say to you. But you got to hold on to the truth and say, in Christ, I am already rich. It's only my circumstances which are going through a tough season right now. God takes us through different seasons of life. None of the seasons are permanent. So if you're going through a season of lack and hardship, that's just a season, because he wants to help you grasp some spiritual truths while you are in that particular phase of life. But that season will pass. So never ever question the status that you have in the Lord, the future which you have in the Lord, just because Satan and sin bring wrong thoughts to you. Because sin and Satan always try to contradict the truth of God, what God declares as right. And in fact, sin and Satan even try to deceive you about who you are in Christ. Okay, so these are things that we need to guard against and watch out for. Okay, coming to another thing. Because sin always contradicts God, therefore, in the Bible, sin is referred to as lawlessness or wickedness, depending on which translation you're reading. This word, Greek word anomia, is used in many, many places. We looked at that word hamartia, which basically means missing the mark. Now, this is another word which is used in the New Testament for the word sin. It's the word anomia, which is sometimes translated as wickedness in our Bibles, in our English Bibles. Sometimes the word lawlessness is used. This is basically what it is. Okay, 1 John chapter 3, verse 4, if someone could read out. 1 John chapter 3, verse 4. People, somebody read now. 1 John chapter 3, verse 4.
I'm audible.
Perfectly audible. Go ahead.
1 John chapter 3, verse 4. Whoever commits sin also commits lawlessness, and sin is lawlessness.
Exactly. So, you see, sin is not just missing the mark. It is also direct rebellion against God. God said, this is the law. And you're saying, no, I'll do exactly the opposite of what you are saying. So sin is actually defying God and saying, I refuse to submit to you. So sin is actually something very, very serious. Yes, it is missing the mark, but it's not just something, as innocent as missing the mark. It is outright rebellion against God, where you're saying, yes, Lord, I know that this is your law, this is your command, but I choose not to submit it. I choose to defy what you are saying. So if you look at it that way, sin is something extremely serious in God's eyes. You are basically holding the law of God in contempt, you know, not showing respect for what he has said. So in that sense, sin is a very serious act of rebellion. In 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 4, it talks about, that word is used over there, anomia, which means lawlessness. If someone could actually read out for us, 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 8. Second Peter 2:8.
For that righteous man dwelling among them tormented his righteous soul from day to day by seeing and hearing their lawless deeds.
Yeah, so that word lawless deeds over there, that is your Greek word anomia. It's talking about direct rebellion. Here in this verse, it's actually talking about those people who lived in Sodom and Gomorrah. You know, God very clearly has given a law that people are not to indulge in homosexual conduct, but this is what these men were indulging in. So they were actually in direct rebellion to what God is telling them to do. No, God said, you will not do this. And they were directly indulging in that exact wrong behavior which God has strictly forbidden. And it says that Lot actually used to feel very, very troubled whenever he used to look at them. You know, so we kind of get a glimpse into Lot's mind and what he thought about the people living in that city. So it says that he used to find it very troubling whenever he used to look at their anomia, at their direct rebellion against what God has, commanded. Now, it's not just those evil people of Sodom and Gomorrah who may indulge in such things. Even we believers can fall into that same temptation. This is what Jesus says about the Pharisees. And of course, the Pharisees were not believers, but that thing which they were doing, you know, can actually be seen even in the lives of believers if we are not careful. So let's look at Matthew chapter 23, verse 28. Matthew 23, 28, please.
Matthew chapter 23, verse 28. Even so, you also outwardly appear righteous to men, but inside you are full of hypocrisy and lawlessness.
Yeah. So here is Jesus is speaking to the Pharisees and he's saying, people have a high opinion of you. You know, because you are the people who stand on the street corners and say long prayers. You're the people who without fail will do fasting. I think they used to do it twice a week or maybe once a week. You know, they will not eat anything that entire day. So people had a very high opinion of them. And God says, you know, when God looks at them on the inside, he says, you're filled with lawlessness, direct rebellion against what God wants. That's the way you're living. And so we believers can look very, very righteous on the outside. But are we filled with anomia on the inside, you know, in our attitudes, in our motives, in our thoughts, you know, the kind of thing, the things that we think, are we living in rebellion? So this is a dangerous place to be. So therefore, Titus 2:14 gives us this assurance. Titus chapter 2, verse 14.
Titus chapter 2, verse 14, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from every lawless deed and purify for himself his own special people, zealous for good work.
So we don't have to have all this lawlessness inside us. There is hope because Jesus Christ, he gave himself on the cross. Why? So that he can redeem us from all anomia. So that he can redeem us from all lawlessness and purify for himself a people, you know, that are his very own. So we can go to the Lord and say, Lord, in a lot of attitudes and motives, when I look at them, I'm realizing that I'm in direct rebellion with what you want. So you can say to the Lord, you died on the cross to redeem me from such attitudes and from such behavior. So, O Lord, please, because you have promised this in Titus 2:14, purify me from these things so that I may, you know, live for you. So when we reach out to the Lord and stand on the scripture, through the work of the Holy Spirit, we can start overcoming this attitude of lawlessness, this attitude of rebelling against what God wants. You know, we can overcome that in our lives. All right, we are kind of running out of time. We are always out of time. Just, you know, one verse, even as we have been talking about all of these things, sin and what it can do to people and all of that. Deuteronomy chapter 1, verse 39. Deuteronomy 1, verse 39.
Deuteronomy chapter 1 verse 39. Moreover, your little ones and your children, who you say will be victims, who today have no knowledge of good and evil, they shall go in there to them. I will give it and they shall possess it.
Yeah, I mean, because we are kind of out of time, I just wanted to touch upon this without fail. It is true that all people are born with a sinful nature. So little children, right from babyhood, they have the sinful nature inside them. But we see over here in Deuteronomy 1:39 that before a certain age, they are not yet fully aware of what is right and what is wrong. You know, a baby really has no awareness of what is right and what is wrong. So this is what, you know, in doctrine of sin, it's called the age of accountability. For different children, it will be different. Some kids get this awareness of right and wrong, you know, more quickly. For some, it takes longer for them to understand what is right and what is wrong. So different children reach this age of accountability at a different time, maybe 2 years, 3 years, maybe even 4 years, depending on how quickly the child develops in their thinking and all of that. This is basically what, you know, is generally doctrinally held by almost all Christians, that any child who dies before the age of accountability is reached, you know, because they have not fully still understood this whole idea of sin and what is right and what is wrong, the Lord will take them into heaven, you know, even though they have not grown up, you know, even though they have not grown old enough to say a salvation prayer and understand what they are saying. You know, so any child who has still not fully understood this whole idea of sin and right and wrong, if the child dies in its sinful nature, the Lord will accept that child into his kingdom, because he cannot yet hold them accountable. They are still not aware of these concepts. Of course, after maybe the age of 3 or something, I think the child starts having an awareness of what is right and wrong. Because, you know, if you tell the child, did you take the biscuit? Instinctively, the child will say, and hide the biscuit behind their back. So I think by then they have developed an awareness of, oh, what I'm doing is bad. And they may not understand the whole idea of sin and all of that, but they already have beginning to get an idea of what is. So that's something that we leave in the Lord's hands. The Lord is just. He is fair. He would never do injustice. So if a child, happens to pass away before they can fully understand these concepts, the work of the cross will cover, you know, whatever wrongdoing they have done, it will be covered by the work of the cross. That's just basically a teaching that almost all denominations, you know, hold on to. Also, just one. Okay, there's really no time. That's very sad. Okay. Just this thought of wages of sin. You know, we are very, very familiar with that verse, Romans 6:23. It says, the wages of sin is death. What does this term mean? It's talking about sin like as if sin is a boss. You know, sin is a master who, and there are people who have decided to come and work under this master. And so at the end of the day, the master gives the wages, the salary to all the people who have chosen to come and work under this particular master. Sin is like that. People allow themselves to become slaves of this master. And what are the wages? What is the kind of salary that this sin gives to the people who are under it? Three things. You know, the wages of sin is death. And so there are three kinds of death which sin pays to the people who are doing the works of sin. There is, of course, spiritual death, which is what happened to Adam and Eve. You know, they were, before their sin, they were spiritual, they were righteous spirit beings. But after the fall, they became sinful spirit beings. So obviously there's a spiritual death which takes place. The second type of death is the physical death which everyone undergoes. And the third kind of death is completely being cut off from God's presence for eternity. That is a terrible thing which happens to people who, you know, have chosen to live under the control of sin. This is the wages which they get from sin, that they will be cut off permanently, eternally, forever and ever from the presence of God. Okay, so these are the three kinds of sins. These are the three kinds of wages which sin gives to the people who serve under it. All right, yeah, there's no time to cover any other concepts. So let's just close with a small word of prayer. Lord, we just thank you so much for the things that we could cover today. We pray, O Lord, that you would help us to live victorious lives because we are now a new creation. We are no longer that helpless people who could not overcome sin and rule over sin, but because now we have been made into a new creation, help us, O Lord, to set our minds on the things of the Spirit so that the Spirit can help us live a victorious life. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Those of you who are, you know, in the Google Classroom, if you have additional doubts, please put them in the, you know, in your Google Classroom page. I will personally answer all of the questions, all right? So please put your questions in the stream page, the Google stream page, and I will answer them. Thank you. Thank you.